بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Dear colleagues and friends, today we are going to have the introduction session for the November 2022 exam attempt. Our course is a part 3 MRCOG Mission Possible course. Actually, I don't like to say this will be a trial for November 22. You are going to pass this exam. It's not a trial. So you still have 5 months. 5 months, it is a very good time for preparing yourself. So you are going for this exam to pass. It's not a trial. There is no time to try. There is no enough money to pay for the college and to pay for the courses each time just to have a trial. So inshallah, you are going for the exam only to pass. Only to pass. There is no other way of thinking in going the exam this time. If you are thinking that you are going for a trial this time, I think it's time to leave our group. Our group is only for those who are thinking in passing only. So today, I'm not the expert. I'm only a guide. I cannot teach any one of you anything. What I'm going to do, I will make you think. I will try to help you and to guide you to the way they are thinking in the Royal College, the way you will pass the exam. It is the same phrase that Socrates said so many years ago. I cannot teach anybody anything. I can only make them think. And this is the idea of this course, inshallah. What I want to tell you, that you passed the part one and part two. So you have the information and you have the knowledge to pass the exam. Maybe you are much, much better than me in the clinical knowledge, especially those people who recently passed. You may have knowledge that's much more updated than my knowledge. So all what you need in this exam is some acting abilities. If you can act, if you know how to pass the exam, it will be very easy to pass. And if you can act with some knowledge, I cannot say without knowledge at all, with some knowledge, you will definitely pass the exam and you will be on the stage and your Oscar will be the certificate of MRCOG, inshallah. I don't know if this will be a good news or no for all of you, but this message I got from someone of you, they contacted the Royal College and they informed them that there is still possibility for some candidates to have an online exam in November. So those who will attend the exam from London definitely will have face-to-face examination. Any country with an examination center like India, China, Hong Kong, Egypt, and UAE, the candidates may go also for face-to-face examination. But any candidate that registered his address outside these countries still have the option to choose either to go for the remote exam through the OSLR examination or to go to the face-to-face examination. It will be depending on your choice. So if you will have the option to choose online examination, my advice, please choose online this time. The online examination, you will not have to spend much money in tickets, in hotels, in visa. and you will not waste your time in traveling between countries to go for the exam. But if your only option is to go for face-to-face examination, just go for it. I told you I don't like to say a trial. Trial means you are going to try, so there is possibility that you will pass or you don't pass. But I have to say it here. The first attempt online exam will not be counted in your four trials. And the four trials is a trap, because candidates will go just to try and they will not perform their best in preparation. So they may lose one or two trials because they still have four trials to go. So please, again, I am concentrating in this point. There is no trials. Imagine this is your only and the last trial that you are going for the exam. Again, you don't have time. All of us, we have families. All of us, we need our money. No need to pay your money for the college or for me or for any other course. So this trial will be the last trial, inshallah. For those people who did not attempt the exam before, we have 14 modules in the exam. 14 modules, you will be examined in all the modules during the examination. You will have 14 stations. You will be tested in these 14 modules. You will not go out of the exam without being evaluated regarding the teaching. Actually, the teaching cannot be described as a separate module, because you will find a teaching station in each of the other modules. You will find a teaching in the surgical skills. You will find teaching in urogyny. You will find teaching in pregnancy care, in management of labor. So teaching will be with us in each day of our sessions. You will have the core surgical skills, the post-operative care, antenatal care and postpartum care, the maternal medicine, management of labor and delivery, the gynecological problems and the gyne-oncology, the subfertility, sexual and reproductive health, and early pregnancy care. These are the modules you will be tested in during the exam. What about the domains? So, in each task during the exam, you will have three or four domains to be tested. And the domains means the clinical skills or your clinical abilities during the exam. So the five domains are patient safety, communication with patients and their relatives, communication with colleagues, information gathering, and applied clinical knowledge. So these are the domains that you will be tested during the exam. In each task or in each station, you will have three or four domains to be tested during the station. Very rarely that you will have the five domains to be tested. As we said, the exam is composed of 14 tasks or 14 stations. You will have 2 minutes at the beginning for the reading time. If you are going for online examination, it will be 2.5 minutes. There will be several circuits running at the same time in different countries. And in each country, there will be morning and afternoon session. In each country, the morning and the afternoon session will be the same. So candidates will be kept separated from the afternoon and the morning, so the exam will be fair. You will have 2 minutes outside the booth or outside the cubicle. And then you will enter inside. You will have 10 minutes for interaction or for the task time. During the 2 minutes for the reading time, you will have the candidate instructions in front of you. Sometimes you cannot finish all the instructions in the 2 minutes. Please do not get panic. Do not be stressed. You will find the candidate instruction outside the booth, and you will find it inside the booth over the table. So if you are going for face-to-face exam, you will find the instruction outside the booth, and you will find it inside over the desk in front of you in the exam. If you are going for online examination, you will have the option to open the candidate instruction all the time. So if you did not manage to finish reading the candidate instruction in the 2 minutes that you have for the reading time, relax, just go inside the booth calmly, introduce yourself to the patient, to the simulated patient or to the examiner, and then take their permission to have another look to the notes for 1 or more minutes to continue reading the notes. This is an accepted behavior in the exam. Just go inside the booth, ask the examiner or introduce yourself to the role player to have one more moment or one more minute to take a look to the candidate instructions. So you will have 2 minutes outside the booth for reading. What is the key for these 2 minutes? What you need to do in these 2 minutes? First of all, you should have a good situation awareness. The first thing you need to ask yourself, if this is a happy task or sad task, am I going to go inside the booth smiling, or I have to go with a neutral facial expression? So the first thing you have to think about it while you are entering the booth, are you going to put a big smile in your face, or you are going to go with a neutral facial expression? So the task will be either a happy task or sad task, especially in case of breaking bad news. You should have a situation awareness about your position, your shift time, and your place. So in all of the tasks, your position, you will be an ST5, because part three examination is examining your abilities as an ST5 practicing obstetrics and gynecology in UK. You should have situation awareness about the time of your shift. Is it in the morning or is it in the night shift? And the place, you are in the clinic, you are in the accident and emergency, or you are in the labor room. So the first thing you should keep in your mind during the reading the task, is it happy or sad task? What's my position? Where is my place? And when is my shift time? If you are going for face-to-face exam, they will give you a block note. They will give you a paper and pencil to write your notes inside these notes. Before the end of exam, they will collect all these materials again. So what you need to write in these notes, even you will have some time to sit before starting the exam, you can write these points in your block note and prepare yourself before standing in front of the booth. You will write what domains to be tested in each task. As I told you, we have 5 domains to be tested, but in each station or in each task, you will have maximum 3 or 4 domains to be tested. Sometimes, and this is a big trap in the exam, there will be no information gathering. The station, you will not be tested in the information gathering. And this is a big trap in the exam, because most of the candidates are wasting almost more than 6 minutes in taking the history. And finally, by the end, they discovered that there was no information gathering requested in this station. So they lost their valuable time in nothing. So please, the first part in each station will be, this is a simulated patient task or a structured discussion task where you will be tested in the following clinical skills or in the following domains. So write in your notes which domains you will be tested in. You have to write the patient name and age, because you will have 14 stations. You cannot remember the name and the age of all patients. If you have an information in the candidate instruction about the body mass index, and you find that the body mass index is abnormal, especially if the patient is morbidly obese, please write it in your notes. Because in some stations, the idea of the station will be about the obesity. And it came before so many times. Patient who is in wheelchair because of spina bifida, or patient with any other condition who has a body mass index of 35 or 40, and the candidate will start discussing the condition like Charcot-Marie-Tooth or spina bifida or whatsoever, and they will forget completely to discuss the effect of obesity in pregnancy, which is a risk management in this case, and they will fail the station because they don't have a situation awareness or they didn't get the main point of the station. So if you have abnormal body mass index, write it in your notes. For those who are going for face-to-face examination, just write diagram. Because if you will have a chance to draw diagrams for the patient, this will be a very good point in your communication skills. Please, in any station or any task, don't forget to mention that you will give the candidate a patient information leaflet. The role player, patient information leaflet. You will give your colleague articles and videos to learn, that you will involve your consultant in the next discussion, and you will arrange the next appointment with your consultant, and you will write back to the GP or the midwife. These are very simple points, but you will lose one point in the communication if you didn't mention the patient information leaflet. You will lose your one point in the communication with colleagues if you didn't mention the consultant, the GP or the midwife. So now you got borderline in the communication because you didn't mention simply the patient information leaflet, the consultant or the GP. That's why candidates are coming out of the exam and asking, I did very well in the exam. Why I didn't pass? Because you didn't mention very simple information. Your time finished without mentioning that you will give the patient a patient information leaflet, you will arrange another appointment with the consultant, and you will write back to the GP or the midwife. So my advice will be, you should mention these points early in the station. Actually, the best practice is to mention the 3 points at the end of the station while you are closing. But in most of the stations, your time will run out and you will not have time to close your station. So it's better to mention these points during the introduction in your agenda. And I will show you how to do it during the stations, inshallah. Agenda. No station without agenda, please. If you didn't mention the agenda, it means you lost so many points and so many marks in the exam. So your agenda for any station, you have to initiate the session. How to initiate the session? You will enter inside and you will introduce yourself to the examiner or to the role player. The next point or the next step in any station is to do the information gathering. The information gathering or the history, please take care. He will ask you to either take a detailed history or targeted history. Detailed history means you have to mention each and every point in the history, starting from the name and the age of the patient till finishing by the mental history, and we will have a scheme for the history in each module. If you are asked to take a targeted history, so you will ask only questions related to the problem that's mentioned in the candidate instructions. Please guys, history, whatever, detailed or targeted, should not take more than 1/3 of the time of the station. So you will have only 3 to 3.5 minutes to finish your history. If you feel inside the station that you passed the 4 minutes, please stop the history and go on with the next step in your station, which will be physical examination. No physical examination without asking the patient for her consent and in presence of chaperone. So if you are going to ask the patient for examination, just make it as a sentence. Don't miss any point in this sentence. I may need to examine you after your consent in presence of chaperone. Then explain what you are going to do in examination. If you will not explain what is the benefit or what is the idea of the examination, you will not take any mark, whatever you will mention in the examination. The next point is to explain if there is any investigation and explain the concerns of the patient. Answer her concern. Before starting management, ask the patient about her concerns or expectations about today's meeting, and start by answering and explaining the concerns of the patient. This is a very important point in the communication. Finally, you will go to the management plan. The management plan should be evidence-based, and this part which will reflect your clinical knowledge about the topic of the station. Finally, you will close the station, or you will close the task. You will close the task by asking the patient about any questions, if she has, arrange another appointment with the consultant, give the patient an information leaflet, and write back to her GP or the midwife, or refer a letter to the one who sent you the patient at the first time. So this is your plan during any station. First, the 2 minutes reading time, you should have a situation awareness, what you are going to write in your notes, what's your agenda, and your agenda, how to initiate the session, how to take an information gathering, what you are going to say and to do in the physical examination, explaining the investigations and explaining the condition and the concerns of the patient, then planning the management. Finally, you will close the session. Am I clear so far? Any questions?
Yes, doctor. Yes, doctor. It's clear.
This is your agenda in any station. This is your plan for any station. In the exam, you will have 14 tasks, either in the online exam or in the face-to-face exam. Out of the 14 tasks, you will have 4 to 5 structured discussion cases or viva. You will have the examiner only. The examiner will be the only one inside the station. And you will have 9 to 10 simulated patient and colleague tasks. So most of the exams in the past 2 years, it was 4 structured discussions and 10 simulated patient and colleague task. From now, you will have 4 or five structured discussion. One of them will be labor room prioritization. So now you know that you will have one structured discussion about the labor room priority. You will have the second structured discussion. It will be a gyne list, or you will have a surgical case or an operation that you will discuss with the examiner. You may have hysterectomy, you may have cesarean section or laparoscopy. You will have a structured discussion about a surgical case. You will have one more structured discussion about post-operative complications. So if you are going for the exam next attempt, you know that you will have three cases, one labor room, one gyne ward or surgical case, and one post-operative complication. So you still have one or two possibilities of new stations. The new station will be about whatever the topic. It may be a medical condition with pregnancy. It may be about placenta previa, which are common in the past few years. So you may go the exam and you know what are the structured discussion cases that will come in the exam. So get ready with this station. You should be very well, and you know how to do the labor room priority station. You should know how to do the gyne list arrangement and what are the risks in each case. You should know the common surgical cases that you will discuss, the surgical steps like hysterectomy, cesarean section, and laparoscopy. And also the post-operative complication. And in these cases, you should know what are the clinical governance issues. Now I'm giving only the headlines, but we will discuss all of these stations during the course, inshallah. So this is about the structured discussion. About the simulated patient and the colleague task, you will have 9 to 10 stations. One of them will be simulated colleague task. It will be a teaching station. In the exam, if you find 2 stations of teaching or 2 stations where you will interact with a colleague, take care. One of them will be a station of bullying or undermining, or colleague under pressure. So there never ever you will have 2 teaching stations in the same exam. So if you find 2 exams, 2 stations for teaching, or 2 stations where you have a colleague, one of them will be bullying or undermining. The next all will be with a simulated patient. 5 stations of them, you will find only clinical examiner. So you will enter the room, you will find the patient only and 1 examiner. 4 or 5 stations maximum, you will find 2 examiner, 1 clinical examiner and 1 lay examiner. And actually, these are the most dangerous stations in the exam. Why are these the most dangerous station? Because you will have double marks in these stations. So these 4 or 5 stations may decide if you will pass the exam or no. So in the lay examiner station, you should perform your best, because you will have double the marks in this station. In the face-to-face exam, if you are going to face-to-face examination, you will have the 14 stations back-to-back. So you will continue the 14 station without any rest in between. But if you will go for the online exam, you will have 7 stations at the start. Then you will take break for 12 minutes. Then you will again have 7 more stations. So 14 stations, 7. Between them, 12 minutes for rest and another 7 stations at the end. This is only for the online exam. But if you are going for face-to-face exam, you will go to the 14 stations back-to-back and you will not stop. And the exam time will be about 2 hours and 50 minutes for the face-to-face examination, because there is no rest in between. And the reading time is only 2 minutes. But if you will go for online examination, most probably your exam time will be around 3 hours and 30 minutes because the reading time is 2.5 minutes and you will have 12 minutes in between the stations for rest. As we said, in the exam, you will have two types of tasks. Either simulated patient or colleague task. This is a simulated patient task. This is the candidate. And here, one clinical examiner and one lay examiner there. This is a simulated patient task. Or you will have a structured discussion. In the structured discussion, you will be here and you will have only the clinical examiner with you in the station. During the station, the examiners will put the marks to avoid forgetting and to avoid any recall bias. At the end of the 10 minutes, the buzzer will sound and you will move to the next station. So the examiners will have 2 minutes to complete your evaluation. So during the 2 minutes reading time, the examiner will complete the evaluation, but the main points will be ticked during the 10 minutes station. He will start the evaluation inside the task. You will be evaluated. You are expected to perform as an ST5 in clinical practice in Ops and Gynae in working in UK. So, what's your position in the UK training? You are here. You are an ST5. You are a registrar. You will not be a senior registrar unless you pass the Part 3 exam. So in the clinical training in UK, there is foundation year 1 and 2. After this, you will take a national training number. Then you will start your specialty training. ST1, ST2, ST3. Before going from ST2 to ST3, you have to pass Part 1 MRCG. Then ST3, ST4, and ST5, this is a core training. Before going to the advanced training, you will have to pass Part 2 and Part 3 MRCG. Why I mentioned this point? Because in some of the stations, the candidates, they are introducing themselves. I am Sroor, or I am Dr. Sroor. I'm the senior doctor in the clinic today. If you understand the teaching or the training program in UK, you are not a senior yet. The senior is ST6 or ST7. So you are a registrar, or you are an ST5, or you are one of the doctors in the clinic today. So when you are introducing yourself, if you are introducing yourself to a patient, say, I am the registrar in the clinic, or I am one of the doctors in the clinic. Don't say, I am one of the senior doctors. If you are introducing yourself to a colleague, you can introduce yourself by name only without doctor. I am Sroor, I am the ST5, because your colleague will understand what is the ST5, but the patient will not understand what is the meaning of ST5. The patient will understand only that you are a registrar or you are one of the doctors in the clinic or in the ward today. Am I clear at this until that point?
Yes.
Okay.
Clear.
I need an interaction. If you have any question at any time, please stop me and ask, especially for people who are going for the first time. Okay, Dr. Ibtihal, are you with us?
Yes, doctor. It's here so far.
Yes. So, any point, please. Anyone wants to interrupt me, just interrupt and ask, please. Okay. Coming to the simulated patient or colleague task. Why candidates fail in the simulated patient or colleague task? They will have all the knowledge. They will have all the information about the station. But the problem, they want to finish the time in showing how much information they have. They want to show themselves. But they will not involve the role player in the station. The role player will keep silent during the station. It will be like a lecture. You are giving a lecture to the role player during the 10 minutes. So no interaction means failure in the station. The role player will be trained about the station. They will have the script of the station. They will have the scenario. And they will have all the relevant details. So they will be given clear instructions for the role player. Ask the candidate these questions if he didn't mention in the station. So the role player will have questions to prompt you, to take you back to the right track. Sometimes you will read the station or you will read the instructions and think that the agenda of the station is running through a different, a completely different way away from the real agenda of the station. So if you have a role player, in between ask, do you have any question? Actually, one of the key points to pass the exam is to ask the role player, do you have any question? So she will guide you back to the right track. So guys, please, you have to ask the role player at least two or three times during the 10 minutes. Do you have any questions so far? Am I clear so far? Am I clear till that point? Before closing the station, ask the role player, do you have any questions before finishing the consultation? The role player will guide you to the right track. Give them a chance to talk. Don't think that they will waste your time. They are giving clear instruction to guide you and prompt you if needed to take you back to the right track. Don't get irritated or don't get stressed when the role player will start showing emotions. They may display some behaviors like anger or anxiety. Don't be anxious, don't get stressed. You know that this is an exam, it's not real life. The patient is acting. So act, you do act. She's angry, she's anxious, calm her down and go back to your track. Don't make the patient behavior change your agenda. Just calm the patient down, just show your empathy during the station, but go back to your right track, go back to the agenda. They will never show extreme behavior. They will never shout or they will not leave the station. Sometimes you will find that the role player will take the chair and go to one side of the station, one side of the booth, or she may give you her side. She doesn't want to talk. This is an acting requirement in the station. So try to gain the patient confidence and they have clear instructions again. If the candidate gain your confidence, give him time and put him in ease to finish the station. So they are not wasting your time. They will not show any extreme behavior. Relax, this is an acting exam. So if the patient starts acting, you should know how to act in front of her. In simulated patient or colleague task, you will have a clinical examiner. And by the way, this is the head of the exam committee. This guy is the head of the exam committee now. You will have a clinical examiner in 5 stations, and you will have both lay examiner and the clinical examiner in the remaining stations. Do not interact with the examiner under any circumstances in the simulated patient or colleague task. They are considering themselves as fly on the wall. They will not interact with you under any circumstances. They will have neutral facial expression. So do not interact with them. Consider them as a chaperone inside your clinic. So in your clinic, you will have the patient and you will have your nurse or chaperone. So they are considering themselves as a chaperone or as a fly on the wall. Don't interact with the clinical or the lay examiner during the simulated patient or colleague task in any way. In the past exams, there will be different behaviors from the candidates and from the examiners. So I think the result of this exam will be delayed because some examiners were new to the exam. So they asked the patient a question in the simulated patient task. And this puts a very big question and exclamation mark about these stations. Some of the candidates, they know the examiner personally, so they greet him by name. So in the exam, the examiner himself will be monitored. There will be quality improvement people that will watch the exam. So in some stations, you may find four persons inside the station. You may find the clinical examiner, the role player, the lay examiner, and someone else. The fourth person will be a person from the quality improvement. So do not get irritated or do not get infused when you find four persons inside the booth. Sometimes you will find two role players, which is very rare, two role players inside the booth, which will be partners, especially same-sex partners. So you will have a clear instructions in the candidate instruction that you will have both or same sex partners. If you don't have, it means that the fourth person is one from the quality improvement department. In the structured discussion, you will find only one person inside the cubicle or inside the booth. This will be the clinical examiner. Again, you will have the candidate instructions outside the booth. You will read the candidate instructions. You will have two scenarios in this case. Either they will give you all the questions about the case and you can go inside and start talking or start your performance, and the examiner will interrupt you only if he is feeling that you are running out of time. So the examiner will have a list of questions just to prompt you to move. So if the examiner interrupts you at any point, don't think that they are not happy with your performance. They are only helping you to move to the next point to be sure that you run through all the points of the station. So do not get upset, do not get irritated during the station if they asked you or they interrupted you. So they are satisfied of this point and they are moving you to the next point. During any form of communication, in the structured discussion or in handover, please remember the SPAR tool. Are you aware of the SPAR tool? Anyone here can tell me what is the SPAR tool?
Yes, doctor.
Yes.
SPAR tools means if any scenario, then we have to explain using the SPAR tools means situation, B background, A assessment, and R recommendation.
Yes, exactly. So in any station, when you have a structured discussion, or you will have a phone call or phone call to your consultant, you are during the time of the labor ward handover, please remember the SPAR. You have to go through the steps of the SPAR during your discussion. So the situation and the background will be mentioned in the candidate instruction. You will mention the situation of the patient, what is the current situation, what is the background information you will be given in the instruction, and if you need any extra information, you will ask the examiner about it. Then the assessment will be the examination and the investigation finding you need for this patient, and finally the recommendation, which will be the management plan. Please go through the SPAR tool during any discussion, any structured discussion with any clinical examiner. This will save your station. you will not miss any point. So the situation, background, assessment means examination and investigation, and finally the recommendation, which will be the management plan. In the exam, you may find linked tasks. What is the meaning of linked tasks? Means you will have two tasks. After each other, the two tasks will be about the same patient. So for example, you may have an intrapartum management task. For example, you have a patient in labor. So in this task or in this station, you will be assessed regarding the module of management of labor and delivery. The next task, they will tell you the same patient in the previous station, she had cesarean hysterectomy because of antepartum or postpartum hemorrhage. So this will be a linked task. Most probably in the second task, it will be an issue of clinical governance. The patient has cesarean hysterectomy. So what you need in this station is the 7 Ds of clinical governance. So you have to debrief the patient. You have to discuss. You have to express the duty of candor. You have to give her the discharge and the red flag signs, documentation, and drills. So in this station, the next station will be most probably a clinical governance station. The point here, most of the candidates who have linked tasks, who perform it bad in the first task, they will get confused and they will get irritated, and this will affect their performance in the next task. You should know that the two examiners of the first task and the second task will not discuss your performance at all. Poor performance in the first task will not affect your marks in the second task. So do not think that if you have a linked task and you perform it bad in the first station, that this will affect your mark in the second station. The examiners will not talk to each other. It's absolutely not recommended that the examiners will discuss the performance of any candidate. Even the lay examiner and the clinical examiner in the same station, they are not allowed to discuss your performance, and each one will give you the marks separately. So they will not sit together and discuss your performance. The clinical examiners are fellows or members of the Royal College. They understand the skills and the competences of the ST5 trainee. They will assess your performance and will help you to move during the task. The standard required will be assessed by the examiner in either pass, fail, or borderline. The examiner himself, as I told you, will be evaluated at the end of the exam. So they will have individual feedback about their performance, especially on the online examination. They will have videos about the performance of the examiner himself. So make sure that the examiner will have a clear points. These points to achieve pass in the task are agreed before starting the examination. So it's not an individual assessment. It is the Royal College recommendation for assessment. So all candidates will be evaluated under the same standard. The lay examiner, the point, the risky point in the exam. The lay examiner may decide if you will pass the exam or you will not pass the exam. The lay examiner is not a medical personnel. He has no medical training. He's recruited from the public. No training or medical background at all. And as I told you, at least 4 or 5 stations from the simulated patient or colleague task, there will be both clinical and lay examiner. The lay examiner will not assist you in all the domains. The lay examiner will assist your communication with the patient and the families, your communication with the colleague and your way of information gathering. So the lay examiner is assessing these three domains only: communication with the patient, communication with the colleague, and the information gathering. They don't have the privilege to assess your patient safety or your clinical knowledge. So the patient safety and the clinical knowledge is only for the clinical examiner. So if you have a station where there is a lay examiner and the clinical examiner, the clinical examiner will assess four domains, and the lay examiner will assess three domains. So in this station, you will be assessed in seven domains. Seven domains means this station will have 14 marks. 14 marks in one station. That's why it is very risky and very dangerous to lose any station where there is a lay examiner. So you should know how to perform in presence of lay examiner. In presence of lay examiner, clinical knowledge is not important at all. The important here is the three domains where the clinical examiner and the lay examiner will assist your performance. So in this station, you have to concentrate on the communication with the patient, communication with colleague, and the information gathering. You will have one extra domain, which will be mostly applied clinical knowledge or patient safety. So you will have seven domains in total in this station, and you will have 14 marks from the clinical examiner and another 6 marks from the lay examiner. So 20 marks in total, 20 marks in one station. So this station may detect at the end if you are going to pass the exam, or I don't want to say all. Inshallah, all of you will pass. The role of the examiner is to help you to pass the exam. There is a misconception that the examiner is there to fail the candidates. All the examiners are trained to give you the opportunity to demonstrate your skills. They are appreciating the stress you will be during the exam. They want to help you to overcome your nerves to perform well during the station. So, do not assume again that they are doing badly if they interrupt you or they advise you to move on. They are trying to ensure that you are able to cover all the aspects in the scenario, so you can have the chance to demonstrate all your clinical skills. So don't get irritated, don't get upset from the way the examiner will deal with you inside the station. You don't know why he's interrupting you. He's interrupting you because he wants you to move on during the station, not to waste your time. Am I clear till that point? Any questions? Any questions?
It's clear, doctor. Oh, it's doctor, clear.
Okay.
Yeah. So, Dr. Sir, yes. May I ask one question?
Yes, sure.
In online exam, if I need to review the question, that case I need to permission?
If you want?
In online exam, if yes. I need to review the question, that case I need permission?
If you want to review the notes?
Yes, review the question.
See, in the online exam, the only way to communicate with the patient or with the examiner is to put your eyes in front of the camera. There will be no way to put your eyes in front of the camera. So for me to communicate with you, to show that I'm looking to you, I have to look to the camera only. So this is not applicable in the exam. But if you want to see your candidate instruction or your brief, just put it in front of you. And if you are going to take a long look to the notes, just take a permission. Can I have a look to your notes, please? From the patient or from the examiner? Just simply take a permission from the patient if you are going to look back to the notes. But you can keep the notes in front of you all the time, and you have to, and you can take a glance to the notes in between, and this will not affect your communication at all. The good point of the online examination, they cannot assess your body language. They cannot assess your eye-to-eye contact, which is very important point in the face-to-face examination. So the only point you need to take a permission is when you are going to take a long look, you will stop talking or interaction for a minute with the consultant or with the examiner or with the patient. Is that clear?
Clear.
Okay, any other questions?
Thank you.
Okay, so actually what I don't like in the MRSOG exam, the MRSOG exam, in my opinion, is not a fair exam. They said it is a fair exam. They are trying to make everything fair as possible, but I don't think it's a fair exam. They said that part two and part three, it is a criterion reference exam. What is the meaning of criterion reference? It means they are comparing your performance, your knowledge in relation to standard score. So the performance of other candidates will not affect your score, which is actually not true. The performance of the candidates in the different exams will determine if you are going to pass the exam or no. You will have in the exam, inside the cubicle or inside the booth, the examiner will give you pass, borderline, or fail. Pass means you take 2 marks in this domain. Borderline means you take 1 mark. Fail, it means you take 0. By the end, this will be converted into numerical score. So you will get a percentage at the end. The percentage of the pass or the pass mark will not be detected before the exam. So it's not a criterion-based exam. It is a norm-referenced exam. What is the meaning of norm-reference? Means they are comparing your performance against the performance of other candidates in the exam, which in my opinion is not fair. So sometimes the pass mark will be 60, sometimes the pass mark will be 65, or at once it was 70. So according to the performance of the candidates in the exam, they are detecting the pass mark. So there is no standard for passing the exam. So you have to perform as much as you can, because the performance of other candidates in the exam will detect the pass mark. So it will detect if you are going to pass or you don't pass the exam. The good point in pass, borderline, or fail, there is no single domain has a greater importance than any other domain. So there was a misconception before that patient safety is very important domain and it is more important than any other domain. But actually, by the end, the patient safety, you will take either pass, borderline, or fail the same as in other domains. So the patient safety will be important only if your overall evaluation is borderline. And they are deciding if you are going to pass or you fail. So at this point, they may consider a borderline candidate with a good mark in the patient safety is a pass candidate, and a borderline candidate with a borderline or fail in the patient safety, it may be considered a fail. But in general, there is no single domain which has a greater importance than any other domains. In the exam, you will have difficult task and usual or easy task. The standard expected in each task will be different. So if you have a task for management of preeclampsia, for example, the standard needed from you to have a pass in this station will be very high. You are expected to have a high standard in this station. But if you have a difficult station like precocious puberty, like amenorrhea, like same-sex couple, like any other topic which is difficult, the standard needed from you to have a pass mark in this station will be lower. So the passing standard may be different on each task, and it may be different on each day of the examination. But by the end, they are trying to have a standard that each candidate will have the same chance of passing the examination if he attended any day of the exam. So if you find a difficult station in the exam, do not get upset, because you may pass this station with little knowledge, because the expected standard needed from you in this station will be lower than an easy station. So you may pass in a difficult station and you may not pass in an easy station, because the standard will be different in each station according to the level of difficulty. Now, why candidates fail in Part 3 examination? I asked you at the beginning if you have trials before, which domains you fail. I can see here that mainly the safety and the communication. Mainly the safety and the communication. Really, I'm surprised that some of you didn't pass in the clinical knowledge. Rarely, the candidates fail in the clinical knowledge. Because little knowledge, the knowledge from the patient information leaflet is quite enough for you to pass the exam. So, all of you have a background information. All the needed knowledge will be collected from the patient information leaflets. So, patient information leaflets are very, very important. So, do not go to the exam, to Part 3 examination, without remembering the patient information leaflet by your heart. Because these are the scenarios of the exam. So, from today, you have to start each day, you have to start at least two patient information leaflets, and I will give you the prescription at the end how to prepare for the exam from today. The real cause of failure in the exam is two problems. The first problem is the stress of the examination. The stress will affect your performance. So, you got stressed inside the station, whatever you have, whatever your abilities, the stress and your nerves will affect your performance. So the second, you are not able to demonstrate the required clinical skills. If the problem is in the nervous or in your nerves or the stress of the examination, so the solution is easy. Practice, and rehearse. That's why from today, you should have an exam partner. I can see here that half of you have exam partners, so the remaining, you should have connection and you should have an exam partner from today. So you are together in the group, so you have to contact each other, and you have to start having a partner from today. Partner is a key for passing the Part 3 examination. Another point, which is a very critical point in passing the Part 3, is the time management. Candidates, they fail in the exam because they didn't have time to finish the task. More than half of the candidates, they spend 6 or 7 minutes in information gathering, in taking the history, which will destroy the station. So if you spend 6 or 7 minutes in taking the history, so 3 minutes only for the examination, the investigation, the management plan, to answer the patient questions and to close the station, this is a disaster. So during our practice, during the course, you will practice in 9 or 10 minutes and you will have a timer in front of you. So you will get used to move between the parts of the station. If you pass the 4 minutes, you have to go to the next point. Information gathering is only one domain out of 3 or 4 domains. So do not waste the time of the station in one domain that you will take only 2 points and lose 3 other domains, you will take 6 points. That's why time management is very important. So practice with your study partner and you should know how to arrange your time, how to manage your time. The recommendations, and these are not my recommendation, is to have course. This is our course. It's not face-to-face, but that's why, dear colleagues, from the next time, your cameras has to be open. Our interaction will be face-to-face. The first point that you will get irritated when you perform in front of the others. From the next time, your camera will be open and you will perform the station in front of all the candidates here. So by the time you will get used to perform in front of the others. And we will have role players in during the stations. So my role, I will be acting as an examiner and you will have role players during the practice. You will interact with them face to face and I will not intervene at all. I will intervene after you finish your time. Then I will give you my feedback and I will give you the keys how to pass the station. So this is regarding the first point, the stress of the exam. The second point, you are not able to demonstrate your skills. So you need to have a study partner. It's a very good practice to record videos for yourself. Actually, when I was going to my exam, I didn't have a regular study partner. So I was doing videos for myself and I was evaluating my performance. It is really a very, very good way of evaluating yourself. You have to see your unconscious behaviors. All of us, we will have unconscious behavior. You cannot detect these behaviors without seeing your performance. So from today, you have to practice the stations and see how you are practicing. Record for yourself. You need useful guidance. I hope, inshallah, I will be this guide to improve your skills in order to succeed. So the main points for failure are the stress and to know how to pass the domains. It's not about the clinical knowledge at all. Am I clear so far? Yes, Dr. Aliya.
Doctor, I just want to ask that in my exam, I passed only 2 domains and my degree was 50. I just want to know, it's the degree that important or the passing the domain?
I'm sorry, I didn't get your question. Where? Passing the domain or what?
Or the degree. My degree was 50. The pass degree was 60.
I explained this, Dr. Aliya. In the domains, you will take borderline, pass or fail. So borderline means 1. Pass means 2. Fail means 0. By the end of the stations, they will convert the borderline pass or fail into numerical assessment. So you will have a mark at the end. So both of them are the same. So the mark is your pass or borderline or fail in the exam. They will convert it into a numerical evaluation at the end. So 50 means this is your mark during the exam in the domains itself. Am I clear? So if you bust this domain means you got 2. 2 + 1 + 2 + 5 + 2. At the end, you get 50 out of 100. Okay, so it is the same. But in the exam, during the exam time, the examiner will give you either borderline pass or fail in the domains. Then the exam committee will convert the pass into two, the borderline into one, the fail into zero. Then they will collect these marks and they will give you the final mark. So 50 means this was your performance in each and every domain in the station. Okay?
So I don't need to pass all the domain. It depends on the final mark.
No, no, not at all. You may fail in one of the domains, but finally you will pass the exam because of the final mark. If you pass the pass mark, even if you failed in one domain, you can pass the exam. And I have candidates and I have colleagues before who failed in the clinical knowledge, but they still pass in the exam. Okay, so yes, please.
Dr. Surur.
Yes.
You mentioned that we start from today to read the patient information leaflets. What's about the guidelines, articles, and do you recommend any books to be read?
My presentation today is a conclusion about Lisa Job. So you don't have to go and write 350 books. It's not my way to take a copy from any book and to put in the station. But here I put it for a certain point. In my view, there are some changes. I will change your mind today, especially those who went for the exam before. So I should have a reference. That's why I put the Lisa Jones today as my reference. You don't have to go and read books at all. Some talks, you need to read it. There are green talk guidelines and NICE. What you need, especially that you have still 5 months to go for the exam, especially if you passed the part two since a long time, what's needed from you is to read the summary at the start of each guideline. You don't have to go and read all the guidelines. Because the NICE and the green top and the strategy and the TUGS will need 3 months for alone to finish. So you don't have to go and read all these. And by the end, I will give you the prescription from today, how to start preparing yourself. How? The patient information leaflet is the most important. The patient information leaflet, you have to read it and remember it by heart. Because the questions in the patient information leaflet will be the questions of the patient in the station. The patient information leaflet way is your way of communicating with the patient. The jargons are avoided in the patient information leaflet, so you will learn how to avoid the jargons if you study the patient information leaflet from today. But still, you may need the green top and the NICE guideline for the structured discussion. But you may need all these guidelines, green top, NICE, and TUGS for one station only. So you have to go and review all the guidelines just for one station. And this station may come from the recalls that we will discuss during the course. So it means you waste very valuable time in things that will benefit you on only one station. Because the recalls will give you all the information you need besides the patient information leaflet and the summary at the start of each guideline will be enough. Okay? Any other questions? Welcome. Any other questions? There was someone else raising his hand.
Yes, sir, I want to ask, so we shouldn't go for all the topics in the talks in the last 3 years, only the recall stations.
Take the topics from the records. If you didn't read it before, just go through them quickly. And I will give you a key answer for each of these stations. So you will have the basic knowledge. If you want to refresh your knowledge more, I will be happy to listen to you because I'm busy all the time preparing the stations. So I will get benefit also from you if you have time to read these talks and the new guidelines. But for passing the exam will be enough for the information leaflet and for the summary at the start of each guideline.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Do you need to take a rest for 5 minutes?
Yes, doctor.
Okay, so we will have rest for 5 minutes and then we will come back. If anyone has any question, you can ask me now. Okay. We will come back at 9:38. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Hello again, everyone.
Ji wa alaikum assalam.
You are all there. I can start.
Yes, doctor, you can start.
Okay. So, any questions till now? So, now moving to the domains of the exam. We said that we will have 14 tasks in the exam. In each of the 14 tasks, you will find the first sentence in the exam that this is a structured discussion or simulated patient task. And please take care of these points because some candidates, they will go inside the station. They don't know what type of station they will have. So, structured discussion or simulated patient. This is the first situation awareness point. The next point, the domains you will be examined. So you are going to be assessed in the following clinical skills. The following clinical skills, we have five domains. The patient safety, the information gathering, communication with patient and families, communication with colleagues, and applied clinical knowledge. These are the five domains that you will be tested in. Maximum, you will have three or four domains in each station. Please take care. Take care if you have asked to take an information gathering or no, because some station, you will not be asked to take a history from the patient. And this is a critical point in some stations, because there are so many other tasks you have to do and you wasted the time in taking history, which you will not be marked for during the station. So the domains, the first domain is the patient safety. I can see here that most of the candidates who didn't pass in their first attempt was because of the safety. Safety is a common is common between all of you. So why candidates fail in the safety? Very easy points, you will discover that you forgot very, very easy points and you lost marks in the exam because of these points. The patient safety points that has to be mentioned in all the cases include call for help. If you have any emergency situation, you should recognize your limits, the limits of your ability and the call for help. So remember to mention the consultant in each and every case, urgent or not urgent, just say the consultant in the station. I will inform my consultant. I will ask the help of my consultant. So consultant itself in the station, it is one mark. It will affect your communication with colleague and you will lose another mark in patient safety if you need your consultant in an urgent situation. So to forget to mention the consultant, you will take borderline in the patient safety and borderline in communication with colleagues. The confidentiality of both the patient and the organization. If in some cases, like the sexual abuse, like the domestic violence, you have to mention the point of confidentiality. You have to reassure the patient that her confidentiality is maintained. And this will affect the safety in some stations. The duty of candor. All of you, you know the meaning of the duty of candor. I'm sure that most of the people or all the people who went for the exam before, they know the duty of candor. Dr. Ibtihal and Dr. Rehana, do you know what's the duty of candor?
Yes, it is about to be open and clear to the patient and yes, to apologize for any complication or any mistake.
Yes,
and exactly. Open and clear to the patient.
Yes, exactly. So to be honest, apologize and give the patient all the information about the complication, why it happened, how it happened, and what are the further steps. So this is the duty of Condor. It is one of the failure point in the patient safety, especially in risk management cases. So if you have a case of post-operative complication and you didn't mention the duty of Condor, you will fail in the patient safety. Please avoid undermining your colleagues. I will give you an example. If you have one patient who came transferred from the GP and you need to examine her, the patient will tell you, no, I don't want another examination. I was already examined by the GP. If you say that the GP is not competent or the you know more than the GP, this means you are undermining your colleague. So there is a special phrase I will tell you about it. It will avoid undermining the colleagues. You can tell her there are so many other reasons for condition, so many other possibilities. I have to explore and examine you myself. This will help me to decide your management plan. Don't mention your colleague at all, because if you mention your colleague at any point here, you will lose a point in the patient safety because you are undermining your colleague. Understanding how to obtain an informed consent and what is the competency of the patient, which patient is competent to sign a consent, it is a point of safety. I already did a lecture about the consent on the YouTube. You can go through it. And we will discuss this station again during the course, so we can decide which patient is competent to sign a consent and which patient is not competent. Respect the dignity of the patient at all times, even in emergency situation. For example, in case of cord prolapse, if you are going to tell that I will put the patient in certain position and take her to the theater immediately, just mention in between to maintain the patient dignity, cover the patient, inform her. So this point will save you from compromising the patient safety or the patient dignity. As I told you at the beginning, no examination without chaperone. No examination without chaperone. If you mention examination without mentioning the chaperone, means you lost 1 point in the patient safety. You will take borderline. You did everything well and good in the station, and because you didn't mention chaperone one word, you will take borderline in the patient safety. So take care, please. Simple points, simple words will save your neck and will save your task during the examination. You have to respect the patient reliefs and cultural issues. The most common example of this is the Jehovah's Witness patient. If the patient is Jehovah's Witness, she needs a blood transfusion, but she's refusing. This means you have to respect her beliefs and her cultural issues, even if this is going to affect her safety. But respecting the autonomy of the patient, respecting her belief, is a point of safety. So if you didn't mention this, this will affect your mark in the safety. Also, respect the patient's cultural issues. The most common example for this is a female genital mutilation. But you should respect the cultural issues. If for different patients in UK, if this cultural issue is not breaking the UK laws. So, for example, female genital mutilation is not allowed in UK. So this point, you will inform the police, even if this is against the cultural beliefs of the patient, because here, if you didn't inform the police, you are compromising the safety of the patient and the safety of other family members, other children at home. If there is a child or adult, vulnerable group, those patients with domestic violence, those patients with IQ issues, those patients in social housing, these patients are called vulnerable groups. You have to mention the safeguarding in this station. If you didn't mention the safeguarding nurse or the safeguarding department in this station, you will have borderline in the patient safety. So in cases of domestic violence, in cases of sexual abuse, in cases of children or minors who came for abortion or who came for sexually shared infection, you have to involve the safeguarding in this station. Not involving the safeguarding will compromise your mark in the patient safety. Safe prescription means if you are going to mention any drug in any station, please, with the drug, say after excluding the allergy. So I will give this patient antibiotic after excluding the allergy. I will review her medication and I will change the medication after reviewing the allergy. I will give her painkiller or antiemetic after excluding any allergy. So drug, allergy. Allergy, it should be included in any station, whatever the station. Allergy has to be there, even in a structured discussion. Mention the allergy, please. The allergy is a critical point in the patient safety, so it has to be involved in each and every station. Some station, you have to mention about the drug interactions. So if the patient is coming for contraception and she is taking anti-epileptic medication, so you have to take care of the interaction with the hepatic microsomal or enzyme-inducing drugs. If the patient is menopausal and she wants to take herbal medication, you have to exclude the drug interactions. Any drug you are going to give in the exam, you should know the route, the dose of administration, and the side effects. I don't want to tell you that you should know all the modes of action, all the side effects of all drugs, but at least the common drugs in obstetrics. So it's not acceptable to mention magnesium sulfate in a case of preeclampsia, and you don't know the signs of the toxicity, and you don't know what is the antidote. Because if you are going to mention the magnesium sulfate, you should tell what are the prerequisites before giving the magnesium sulfate, what are the signs of toxicity, what is the antidote in case of toxicity, which is calcium gluconate. So this is for the most common drugs that will be used. Failure point in the exam, if you didn't exclude pregnancy, if you will not do pregnancy test for any patient before surgery, taking any patient to surgery without doing a pregnancy test for patient in the childbearing age is a failure point in the patient safety. So that's why you will come out of the exam and you are telling, I did well in the station. Why I failed? You failed because you forget to say pregnancy test. You forgot to say pregnancy test. That's why you failed in the safety. You forgot to mention the WHO surgical safety checklist in surgical cases. So only one word will affect your mark. It will change your mark from pass to borderline or even to fail. Safe surgical techniques, when you are discussing a case, for example, hysterectomy or laparoscopy, there are some points and some techniques that we will mention during the stations in the course. These points you have to mention in each case and it will be individualized according to the case. Your ability to triage and to prioritize the cases in the labor and the gyne ward is a point of patient safety. So if you are not able to mention which case is urgent, which case needs immediate intervention, means you are not a safe doctor and you will fail in the patient safety. If you have a patient with cancer and you didn't mention that this patient needs urgent referral to the multidisciplinary team, within the 2 weeks pathway, you will have a borderline in the patient safety. Understanding the clinical governance and the reflective practice is important in patient safety. So if you have a complication in any case, you have to mention the clinical governance issues. What are the common mistakes the candidates will fail in the patient safety? The candidates will not understand the issues of the clinical governance. They will have a complicated case. They will not discuss the 7 Ds of clinical governance: debriefing, documentation, datics. Dr. Aliya, why you are drawing in our screen? Okay, thank you. So, number one, not understanding the clinical governance issues, not understanding what is the meaning of audits and reflective practice, not understanding what is the duty of CONDOR. So these are the common failure points in the patient safety. So these points, what we mentioned, all these points are points of safety. If you didn't mention them, it will affect your mark in the patient safety and you will come out of the exam and asking why are failed in this station. How to improve or how to develop your patient safety skills? This will answer your questions, Dr. Amal and Dr. Sadia. Do you need to go for the guidelines? Selected guidelines you have to go for. So you have to review the guidelines on obtaining the consent. And we will discuss this already, and I already discussed in one of the YouTube lectures. You have to know how to assess the mental capacity of the patient, especially in minors. Minors under 16 or under 18, you should know if they understand, they can repeat and retain the information you are giving to them, so they are competent, they can give a consent. The patient safety, it is very important to practice how to write a prescription. What are the indications of the drugs? What are the side effects of the commonly used drugs? And what are the antidote of some drugs? And what are the signs of toxicity? And again, this is for the most commonly used drugs in obstetrics and gynecology, not each and every drug. Remember the WHO surgical safety checklist. If you are going for any surgery, WHO surgical safety checklist. If you are going for any surgery, pregnancy test for patients in the childbearing age. Safeguarding principles in cases of domestic violence, sexual abuse, or child abuse. Please remember the clinical governance issues in any station, especially stations of post-operative complication. This is a way to improve your skills in patient safety. So this was the first domain and one of the important domains, because as I told you, there is no domain which is important than the other. But if you have your final mark is borderline, passing in the patient safety will help you to pass in the exam. Any questions in patient safety before moving to the next domain?
Yes, sir. I want to ask this, that mentioning WHO safe surgery checklist, is it okay in case of SPTs? Should we mention it? Is it in, isn't it a jargon?
In case of what?
In case of simulated patient task, should we mention the WHO checklist?
No, you will not tell the patient WHO surgical safety checklist. This will be in the structure discussion.
Okay. And sir, when we will involve the microbiologist in prescription of antibiotics?
If you have a case of sepsis, you should involve the microbiologist. Any case of sepsis, yes, you should involve the microbiologist. This will be one of the multidisciplinary team involved in the case, in the care of this case.
Okay. Thank
you. Any other questions? Okay, so moving to the next domain, communication with patient and families. This is another domain in which the candidates will fail. Because we are overseas, we don't know how to communicate with the patient. So before starting this domain, the solution is a patient information leaflet. So if you know how to study the patient information leaflet, if you remember it by heart, you can communicate with the patient in the proper way. The problem in communication with patient and families, you have only 10 minutes. During this 10 minutes, you are asked to build a strong relationship with the patient or with the role player. So this is a skill that you need to practice. It is difficult. It is difficult skill to gain actually, especially for overseas candidates. So the solution, the patient information leaflet and the daily practice. Patient information leaflet and daily practice will improve your performance in the communication. And you should not feel embarrassed to perform in front of the others. That's why, again, from the next session, the cameras will be open, please. Communication involves the ability to talk to the patient, to inform her, to engage her during the discussion, to negotiate with the patient, and to involve her in her decision-making. That's called shared decision-taking. Here we have to answer why candidates with a good knowledge, they passed part one and part two examination, why they fail in the communication in the part three examination. Number one, in any station and in any communication is introduction. You will be surprised that so many candidates, because of the stress of the exam, they forget to introduce themselves to the patient in the exam. So when you enter the station, again, either it is a good station with a good smile or sad station with a neutral face expression, I am Dr. Sroor, I am the registrar, or I am one of the doctors in the clinic today. If he's a colleague, don't say doctor, I am Sroor, I am the ST5. So now I introduced myself by name and by role. By name, it will be Dr. Sroor for the patient. It will be Sroor for my colleague. My role, it will be the registrar or one of the doctors in the clinic for the patient. And it will be the ST5 for my colleague. So this is number one in the communication. Introduce yourself by name and role. If you didn't mention this, borderline in the communication. So now you are continuing your station for one more mistake and you will fail in the communication. So take care, please. You should remember to introduce yourself by name and by role and proper introduction that will differ from the candidate or from the colleague. It will be different from the simulated patient. The second step in communication is to check the patient name. So I am Dr. Sroor, I am one of the doctors in the clinic today. So can I confirm your name and the age, please? So you check the name of the patient. The next step, ask her how she would like to be called, especially in young or middle age patients. How would you like to be called? But in old age patients or in very young patients, the approach will be different. So in very young patients, you can call them immediately by their name. So Sarah is 14 years old. So go directly and tell her Sarah. But if she's 60 or 70 years old lady, so it's better to call her Mrs. John or Mrs. Edward. So it will be a polite way of calling an old age lady. It will not be a good way if you call her by her name. So in very old patients and in very young patients, the approach will be difficult. It will be different. But in the middle age, you can ask how she would like to be called. Please remember, in any station, ice. You have to break the ice in any station. Ice means I for ideas, C for concerns, and E for expectations. So in any station, after explaining the aim of the consultation, you will ask the patient, do you have any other concerns or expectations today? Why this is very important and critical in in-station? Because the concerns and expectations of the patient may change your agenda completely. The patient may raise an issue at the start of the station that will save your time instead of wasting the time in your own agenda. So for example, if the patient is coming at the booking visit, you are entering the station that you will go through the early pregnancy care module. But suddenly the patient, when you ask her, do you have any concerns or expectation? She suddenly tell you, I'm not happy with this pregnancy and I need termination. So this will reflect on your performance, and this will twist the station completely. So please, in any station, don't forget to ask about any concerns or expectations. This is a critical point in any station. If you didn't mention it, you will be surprised by the end at 8 or 9 minutes that the patient now raises an issue, and this is the main core of the station, and you wasted 8 or 9 minutes in discussion without any benefit, which is completely away from the patient concerns. So please, I am Dr. Sroor, one of the doctors in the clinic today. Can I confirm your name and age, please? How would you like to be called? I understand, of course, you have to make a rapport. Nice to meet you. How are you doing today? I understand that you are here referred from your GP because of 1-2-3. Do you have any other concerns or expectations today? After exploring the aim of the consultation, according to the instruction or according to the referral letter, you have to ask if she has any other concerns or expectations. The next point, communication is verbal and non-verbal. And this will be a critical point, especially on face-to-face examination. On online examination, the communication was mainly verbal communication. It will be difficult to assess the non-verbal, the body language, and the eye-to-eye contact. But if you are going for face-to-face examination, you should know that the communication is verbal and non-verbal. Verbal, the way you are talking to the patient, your tone during the discussion. The problem, most of the candidates are going like robots inside the station. In previous courses and seeing different candidates performing, I feel that as if he is reading, he's not talking to someone. There is no emotions at all during the discussion. So the verbal communication includes the tone. You have to have a high and low tone during the discussion according to the situation. You have to show that you are actively listening to the patient. Actively listening means you are nodding, yes, and making encouraging sounds. So just moving your neck and okay, means you are following and actively listening to the patient. And this is a point that will be evaluated by the lay examiner. So just a simple movement by your neck and simple tone from here, without opening your mind, your mouth, will affect your communication. So this is a skill that you have to practice from today. Showing empathy and appropriate emotional response. So if you are giving the patient or you are breaking the bad news of the patient, you have to put yourself in her shoes. You have to show that you have the same pain that she has. You understand and you appreciate her condition now. If she's happy, say congratulations. If she's sad, say, I'm so sorry for your loss. This is the way how to show empathy and how to show appropriate emotional response. And we will discuss this in details in different stations during the course. To show a good empathy, you have to pause briefly. So you break the bad news. So break the bad news and stop for 5 to 10 seconds. the lay examiner and the clinical examiner will mark you in this part. So you did very well in the station. You know what to do, but very simple things. You don't want to waste your time. So you just break the bad news and you continue the station without any interruption. And you will lose the marks in spite if you mentioned that you mentioned all the points in the station. So you can pause briefly. You can overhear tissue. And in the station, if you find the tissues in the disc, if you find water in the disc, means you have to use them. There is nothing that will be put over the disc without benefit. If you find any probes or any mannequins, you have to use them. Not using the tissues or the water, or not using the probes and the mannequins will affect the way, will affect your mark in communication. Open posture. Don't cross your hand. Don't close your hand during the station. This position means you are in stress. This is not a welcoming position. So this position will affect your mark in the communication. This is a good point for the online examination because they will not see you. All what you see is my head and my shoulders. But in the face-to-face examination, your body language and your posture during the station will affect your way or your mark in the communication. It is a good practice to use jokes or humor in suitable stations, but it will be very risky in other stations. So I don't advise you to use this behavior during the stations. Actually, in my exam, I used it and it was a good practice and I gained the patient very early and it was a very funny station, but it will be very risky if there is any hidden agenda during the station. So I don't advise you to go with this behavior. As I told you, there is unconscious behavior for each one of us. Someone is scratching his face. He's doing some movements with his hands, some jerky movements. He has some tremors. So start recording for yourself and your partner during the practice. This will improve your performance and your way of communication and will tell you which behavior you have to remove, which is unconscious behavior. Very important again, to give the patient or the simulated patient a chance in the station. You should actively listening to them. If they become irritated, if they look away from you, if they give you their side and they don't want to interact, they are giving you a cue that there is something you have to explore more. So they are telling you, I have a problem. You didn't ask me about it. So please ask me. Ask me if I am exposed to domestic violence, if I'm under any form of stress, if there is anything that I'm concerned about. So don't think that they are not interested or they don't want to help you. They are trying to help you by showing this attitude. These stations may be a stations of domestic violence, sexual abuse, or coercion. So take care, please, of these behaviors from the role players during the station. All these are communication points. All these are very important in the communication. Again, the points of failure. Some candidates under the stress, they forget to introduce themselves to the actor and address himself or herself by name and role. So the first thing to be done in the station is to introduce yourself by name and role. Don't waste your time during the 2 minutes reading by writing unnecessary information. It is not exam of the short-term memory. So if you forget any information, if you forget even the name or the age of the patient, you will have the candidate instruction in front of you, either on the desk or in front of you on the screen. so you can have a glance down and say the and remember the patient name or age, and this will not affect your mark. If you need to take a long look to the notes, just take the permission from the examiner if it is a structured discussion, or permission from the patient after introducing yourself to her and after confirming her name and age. Just you can take a permission saying, can I have one more moment to have a look to your notes, and then go back and read whatever you want to know. This will not affect your communication. Other points in the communication. Taking relevant history. History will be evaluated in the information gathering and in the communication. The information gathering, the points you will take during the history, but the way you are communicating with the patient to take the history, this will be assessed as communication with patient and families. Now, we have to correct some mistakes, especially for those who took any courses before or who attend the exam before. It is a common mistake or a common attitude from the candidates. I'm sorry to ask you these questions, but I'm asking for all my patients. Do you smoke? Do you drink alcohol? Do you use any recreational drugs? This is not a good way of asking. And this is a judgmental approach of asking the patient. And you will lose points in the communication if you use this approach. Do not apologize for asking if the woman is smoking or drinking alcohol. Don't say, I'm sorry if I ask you, do you smoke? Do you drink alcohol? These are not illegal activities. This is usual practice, or this is usual activity in their community. So simply, do you smoke? Do you drink alcohol? You may apologize for the recreational drugs. I'm sorry, do you use any recreational drugs? But please, from today, do not apologize for smoking or drinking alcohol. This is their culture and this is their activities. It's not illegal. The recreational drugs is illegal. So you may sign both, or you may apologize before asking about the recreational drugs. But before smoking and before alcohol, this is not allowed. This is a judgmental approach. You are judging the patient, which is not allowed during the communication with the patient. Am I clear regarding this point?
Yes, doctor.
Okay. So, we are not a native English speakers. We are struggling to make full sentences. This is a point that will affect the communication of some candidates. So if your English is not so strong, if your English is weak, you can use simple sentences. This is called chunk, not junk. Don't try to make a full paragraph with the patient. Just give the patient the information in simple, very easy English, simple language. They will not evaluate your English, but they need a clear sentences. So the easy way to do this, give the patient simple sentences and ask the patient if she understands. You have to frequently ask, am I clear so far? Am I clear till that point? Do you have any questions? So ask the patient if she's understanding and ask if she has any questions two or three times during the 10 minutes. If you didn't ask if she's understanding or if she has any question, this will affect your mark in the communication. So if the patient will ask, she will bring you back to the track. Give the patient time, please, from your station. So during your practice, if you are practicing alone, if you are recording for yourself, just practice in 7 minutes. Because at least the patient will take 2 to 3 minutes to communicate with you during the station. So your task, if you are practicing alone, it should finish in 7 minutes. Again, don't forget the eyes. And eyes means ideas, concerns, and expectations. Ask the patient if she has any concerns or expectation from the discussion today. The principles of autonomy. The patient, if she's an adult or she's a competent child, she has the right to make her own decision, even if this decision will affect her life or it is against the medical advice. So you have to respect her decisions, but you have to explain to her. This is the skill of negotiation. And you will find a negotiation station in the exam. For example, one lady who's previous cesarean and she wants to deliver at home. One patient who's breech and she wants to deliver at home. So at this point, you have to show your negotiation skills. The negotiation skill always start by asking why. So if the patient wants to deliver at home, ask her why. This is number one. So now you are exploring her ideas or concerns or expectations. So the first step in the negotiation, why? Then the second step in negotiation, you have to respect her views. Yes, I understand and I respect your views. But, and after but, you will provide her with the suitable information. You will start to compromise, to negotiate where it is safe to do so, where it's safe to deliver for a previous cesarean or for a breech presentation. Explain during the negotiation the consequences of the decision without antagonizing the patient and without over-exaggerating the risk. Because if you are doing this, this is a way you are forcing the patient to take your plan of management. So this is the steps of negotiation. First, you should ask why. So you explored her concerns. The next step in negotiation, appreciate and respect her views or concerns. Then provide her with the information and compromise. Negotiate why or where it is safe to do the intervention. Then explain the consequences and do not over-exaggerate the risk. Then finally, give the patient the full right to take her final decision and support her in her final decision, whatever she is choosing, because this is her right of autonomy. Medical jargons. Again, it will be very, you will be surprised when you record for yourself and you are counting how many medical jargons you are using during the communication. That's why recording for yourself is critical for preparation to the exam. Record for yourself and start counting how many medical jargons I made. For the people who will attend the first trial, Dr. Ibtihal and Dr. Rihanna again. Do you know what's the meaning of medical jargons? Dr. Ibtihal.
The medical terms that the patient can't understand.
Yes, exactly. Dr. Ibtihal, are you there?
Yes, doctor, sorry. Okay. Medical terms. Medical jargon. Medical terms, yeah.
Medical terms that the patient cannot understand. So medical jargons, you have to convert them into plain English. And I provided you yesterday on the drive, in the link drive, with the translation of the medical terms into lay language. So please, each day, take a letter. So today I will take all the medical jargons with letter A and I will see how to convert them into plain English. This is a very important in communication skill. Sometimes in the exam, if you use the medical term, please explain it. It is acceptable. It is acceptable to use a medical term, but it is not acceptable not to explain it in a lay language. So if during the discussion you mention any medical jargon, You have to explain it to the patient. Another point, please. Another point, I have to change your mind today. Vagina and vulva are accepted as lay language. Vulva, the one who's, please close your mic, please. So vulva and vagina are accepted in their communities as a lay language. It is accepted to use vulva and vagina rather than saying down blue. Down blue means, it can mean the vagina, or it can mean the lower floor of a building. Anything below the patient can be considered technically as down blue. So please, from today, forget the phrase, did you do any surgery before in your tummy, pelvis, or down blue? What is the meaning of down blue? Down blue means your legs or your fingers or the floor or below your flat. So this is not accepted. This is not a term to be used in the exam. Did you do any surgery before in your tummy, pelvis, or down below? Means you are not interested if she had surgeries in her chest. It doesn't mean anything for you if she has an open heart surgery. So simply, did you do any surgeries before? That's enough. But saying down below, the frontal passage, what is the meaning of the frontal passage? The frontal passage for a refugee, for example, no. It's a vulva and vagina are accepted as lay language. So please, from today, forget about the down blow or the frontal passage. You have to change this during your communication. Very good in the communication if you managed, if you learn to summarize your discussion at the end. If you have time and you can summarize what the patient mentioned to you during the information gathering, this will be very good and will be very impressive for the examiner, especially the lay examiner. So, the best way of communicating with the patient is to forget that you are in the exam. The best way is to improve your communication skill is to start from today practicing the station with your patients in the clinic or in the ward. So you have to have a frame today for communication. Start from today communicating with your patients in your clinic or in your hospital with the same way that you will do in the exam. And in the exam, deal with the simulated patient as if she is your patient in the hospital. This approach will reduce your stress in the exam. And you will have a fixed approach that you will reduce your stress and you will reduce your anxiety during the exam. Another very important tip, use the physical criteria and the demographic criteria mentioned in the candidate instruction, not the physical criteria of the role player. What I mean, you may have a lady which is 45 or 50 years old, and she's acting the role of 14 years old child. So remember this, that's why it is very important to write the age of the patient in your notes in the 2 minutes before the station. You will find a role player, which is an adult, 40 or 50 years, and acting the role of a minor, 14 or 15 years old. Also, you may find a very slim and lean patient inside the booth, and she's acting the role of morbidly obese lady with a body mass index of 40 or a weight of 140 kg. So again, if you have an abnormal body mass index mentioned in the candidate instruction, write it in your notes, please, because this will affect your performance of the station. You may twist or change the core of the station completely according to the demographic and the physical criteria that was mentioned in the candidate instructions. What are the expectations of the Royal College from you in communication? These are the expectations. The examiners are looking for what in your communication. These are the points that you will take 0, 1, or 2 for the communication. You will take pass, borderline, or fail in these points. Proper introduction. You introduced yourself by name and role, and you checked the patient name and age, and how she would like to be called if she is in the suitable age. Making a rapport. How are you doing today? Nice to meet you. Active listening to the patient. Eye-to-eye contact, especially in face-to-face examination. Asking open questions, and I will explain it in the information gathering. Showing your concern, your empathy, especially if the patient is in a difficult situation. Reflect your feeling. Congratulate the patient if this is a happy situation, and express your condolences if she's in a grave or in a bereavement situation. This is how to show appropriate emotional response. What are the common mistakes in the communication with colleagues, in the communication with the patient and the families? These are the points of failure. The candidates forget to introduce themselves by name and role. From the stress of the exam, they will forget to introduce themselves. They are making assumptions about risky behavior. So if you have a young or a minor who's coming pregnant or with sexually shared infection, please don't start by asking if she has multiple sexual partners. Don't start by asking about the sexual history without signposting and without making appropriate expression. This will affect your point of communication. Feeling embarrassed to ask questions about the lifestyle. I'm sorry to ask if you are smoking or drinking alcohol. This is a lifestyle for these communities. So if you ask, if you feel embarrassed or awkward, you will lose a point in the communication. So please forget the way. I'm sorry to ask, but I'm asking for all my patients. Are you smoking? Are you drinking alcohol? This will affect your mark in the communication. When you are negotiating, listen to the patient. Listen to the patient's views and perspective. Don't tell her you have to do this. You have to do means you are following your plan, you are following your agenda, and you are not interested in the patient's views or concerns. Using unnecessary jargons or abbreviations means you are not understanding, and the patient will not understand what you are discussing with her. If you are using abbreviation, if you are using jargons, please explain it at the moment. How to develop your communication skills? As I told you, make videos for yourself, record for yourself, and see what are the unconscious behavioral movement that you are doing, and you have to stop it. Practice with your exam buddy or your partner the nonverbal communication, how you are making eye-to-eye contact, how you are nodding by your neck, how you are making voices that encourage the patient to continue. Okay. These are points that will affect your communication. Again, tell the information in chunk, not in junk. Small sentences with understandable language. If you have difficult situation, rehearse this difficult situation with non-judgmental approach. Non-judgmental approach. The negotiation skills. Again, why she wants this? Respect her views and wishes. Then give her the information and the adverse effect without overestimation. And then again, respect her final decision. This is a way of negotiation. The medical terminology and the jargons, you have to avoid them. If you mentioned, you have to explain. These are the ways to improve your communication skills, and it will be one of the very important points that I will comment about your performance during the stations. Any questions in the communication with patient and families before going to the next domain? Any questions?
Sir, how do we ask the patient about sexual history?
Yes, sexual history, it may come in two stations. It may come in infertility station, so it will be a broad topic. You have to ask about it in details, or you may have to ask about it in any of other stations like abuse, like dyspareunia or vaginismus, or sexually shared infection. So you have to sign both before asking about the sexual history. You will not accept to go to any doctor. Suddenly, he will ask you, do you have any medical problems? Do you have any surgery before? Then suddenly, can you tell me about your sexual relation? This will be a surprising question for me. This will be very embarrassing. So you have to sign both. What is the meaning of sign both? So you have to give the patient to make her ready, to give her impression, to make herself ready that she will face a difficult question now or very intimate question. So you can say here, now, can I ask you some personal questions? This will affect the way I will manage you or I will treat you. So you are signpost. Can I ask you some personal questions? This is one signpost. It may affect the way of management. This is another signpost. And now you can ask about the sexual history in whatever the situation or in whatever the station. This is a point where you have to signpost. But
yes, sir.
Yes.
Sir, after this signposting, we can ask anything about her sexual shared infections and
yes,
multiple yes, partners. Anything.
Yes, yes.
We don't have to signpost again.
No, already you signpost that you are going to ask her very intimate questions. So the patient will accept anything after that, especially that she agreed. You are taking her permission to ask and she agreed. Now you can ask about whatever you want to ask.
Okay. And sir, in cases like in domestic violence or abuse, and if the patient comes with vaginismus, sometimes there is background events that the patient is hiding. So we give confidentiality to the patient and reassure her.
Yes, exactly.
And even then, if the patient doesn't tell us anything concerning, then we can carry on with the routine management. So for how many times we should ask the patient if there is anything else she wants to tell or if there is anything concerning okay, she wants to tell?
Okay. So in these stations, the role player will not open out from the beginning. Usually she will resist. If you are sure that this is a station of domestic violence, especially in the scenarios that he will mention that the midwife is concerned because the patient has some bruises over her body, so in this station, keep asking the patient every now and then about if she has any concerns and reassure her about the confidentiality. The key points here is the confidentiality. So I want to reassure you that anything that will be said here will remain here. Anything in the discussion between you and me will remain between you and me. No one else will come to know about it. It will not even be mentioned in your notes. So keep mentioning this point to make the role player open early. Because if the role player kept closing and kept maintaining the information, or she didn't show up what is the concern, she may come up out with a point of domestic violence at 6 or 7 minutes of the station, which means you will have only 3 or 4 minutes to continue all the points about the domestic violence. So the sexual history, you will take her permission to ask about intimate or very personal questions. But in domestic violence, the point of confidentiality, the point of maintaining her confidentiality will be the key of this station, and you have to keep asking and insisting about this point, especially if you are sure that this is a station of domestic violence.
Right, sir. And sir, how do we ask about the partner's history if we are concerned about sexually shared infection? How do we ask about this multiple included, partners?
Yes, this will be included in the sexual history.
Okay.
This will be included. After you sign both, you can ask about this in the sexual history. Thank we will you. Come to this in details in the stations. Any other questions? So if you are happy, we'll move to the communication with colleagues. The communication with colleagues, it is the most simple domain in the exam. Just saying one word, you will take the mark in the communication with colleagues. But you will be surprised that many candidates will forget to mention these simple points in the exam, and they will take borderline or fail in the communication with the colleague. Communication with colleague will be either written or verbal communication. Written or verbal communication. So there will be pure stations about communication with colleague. Pure written form of communication, like writing an operation notes, writing a letter for the GP or the midwife. So it is very important to mention it at your agenda at the beginning or at the end before closing the station. Referral letter itself is considered as a way of communication with colleague. The discharge summary and writing the prescription. So these are points or these are full stations that will evaluate your communication with your colleagues. The verbal communication, here you have to mention single word, it means that you take the mark for the communication with colleagues. If you will say multidisciplinary team, you will take the full mark in communication with colleagues. You have to mention the who are involved in the multidisciplinary team. The nurses, the midwives, the other specialties, other members of the healthcare team. Please, as I told you at the beginning, the consultant has to be involved in each station. Either just to inform the consultant or arrange another appointment with the consultant in elective station or to call the consultant to attend and to share in the management now if this is an emergency situation. So just saying multidisciplinary team and consultant, you buzzed in the communication. But some candidates, they will forget to mention about this. The communication at handover, especially the labor ward priority, highlighting high risk patients, the handover tool, the SPAR tool, how you are going to triage and prioritize the patient in the labor ward and in the gyne list is considered as safety and is considered as a point of communication with your colleague. So you are safe that you discovered how urgent is this case, and you have a good communication ability if you will mention this to your colleague during the time of handover. So triage and prioritization is considered as a point of communication with colleague. Teaching station is considered as one of the communication with colleague stations. You will be evaluated in the patient safety and the clinical knowledge and in the information gathering, but this station is mainly about the communication with your colleagues. So please, according to the situation, you will call your consultant, you will call for help, safety, and the communication with colleagues. So if in emergency situation, you forgot to say, I will call for help, you lost one mark in the safety and you lost one mark in the communication. So take care, please. If you have a cancer case, you will mention the multi disciplinary team meeting in the fertility specialist and andrologist. Urogyne, the specialist or the urogyne specialist. In the antenatal care visits, the midwife or the GP to write back. In the sexual health, you will mention the GAM clinic. In any endocrine condition, you will mention the endocrinologist. In the menopausal specialist and the menopause clinic. And the support group, the counselor in any difficult situation. And also the NHS stop smoking service or smoking stop service and the drug and alcohol service. You have to mention this when it is raised during the stage. So these are ways of communication with colleagues. Simple word will save your marks in the communication with colleagues. It will not take any time, just saying multidisciplinary team, consultant, call for help. But the problem with the stress of the exam, you will forget these points. But if you start practicing from today and you will put this slide in front of you with your partner, his just checking if you did this point or you didn't do it, you will learn by time not to forget any point of these points for the communication with the colleague. What are the common mistakes? The main common mistake in the communication with colleague is not using the SPAR tool. So in any communication, especially with the structure examiner, please use the SPAR tool in any form of communication. You have the situation and the background mentioned in the candidate instruction or in the candidate brief. Now for communication, you have to ask about any more information. Any more investigation you need to ask, this will be the assessment. Then finally, the management plan, your justification, and your plan of management will be recommendation. This will save you in the communication with colleagues. For the written tasks, either discharge letter or referral letter or multidisciplinary team or operation notes, you have to use a logical and legible way of writing the notes. You should understand the idea of multidisciplinary team and when it is needed. These are the common mistakes in the communication with your colleagues. So how to improve your ability or your skills for communication with colleagues? Again, practice. In each domain, you have to practice more. From today, try to practice how to write an operation notes. You will have the performer from the Royal College side and practice how to write the operation notes, how to write a prescription, how to write a discharge letter, what is needed and what are the needed points in the discharge letter, what are the needed points in the referral letter. And with your partner, start criticizing or give him his reflection or your evaluation about his way of writing the letter. This will improve your performance. One way of communication is to understand the rules of each one of the healthcare professional. So I mentioned it again in the lecture of labor world priority, what are the rules of the nurses and the midwives in the UK? So when you are delegating the tasks to the midwives or to your junior colleagues, you understand their level of competency and if it's safe to give them this task to finish or not. Get your exam buddy to practice with you difficult teaching station. He will watch you, how you are doing the teaching station. And as I told you at the beginning, we will have teaching station in each module. Because teaching, it involves stations in each module. So we will have teaching in each and every day or in each and every session of our course. So this is a way how to improve your communication with colleagues. These are the common mistakes and the points you need to mention during each station. Do you have any questions in the communication with colleagues before going to the next domain? Any questions?
Clear, doctor.
Okay.
It's clear.
So coming to the next point, which is information gathering. The information gathering is a time-wasting domain. The time-wasting domain. It is important domain, but most of the candidates, they fail the exam because they spent the 10 minutes taking only history. They have a wrong approach, so they are wasting their time. You will be surprised when you record for yourself or when you practice with your partner that you spent 6 or 7 minutes in taking only history. So the time for the information gathering or for the history will be only maximum 3.5 or 4 minutes or 4 minutes at the maximum. If you reach 4 minutes, move to the next step in your agenda. The information gathering is for 2 points and you will have 4 domains. So if you take a borderline in information gathering and borderline or bus in other domains will be much better if you take bus in the information gathering and fail or borderline in other domains because you don't have time and you run out of time. How to save yourself during taking the information gathering is by asking open questions. Open questions means the questions that will allow the role player to give you a brief about her condition, a brief about her concerns. So questions like, how can I help you today? How are you doing today? Can you tell me more about your problem? So the role players are not medical personnel, so they will not know what to hide and what to explore with this open question. So with this open question at the beginning of the station, you may know the hidden agenda. You may know the core of the station. So all the questions, as much as you can, make it an open question. Close the question means it's a question with an answer of yes or no. If you will take the approach of close the question, it means you are building the consultation in your agenda, not on the patient concerns. So can you tell me more about your problem? The patient will start speaking and give you information. Do you have any other concerns or expectations? So another open question, the patient will tell you more about her concerns. So by 2 open questions at the beginning of the station, you may know the idea of the full station and you can now ask the directed questions and you can take a mix or a blend between open and closed questions. The competent candidate will sign both at some certain points of the information gathering. As we mentioned a few minutes back, signposting before the sexual history, signposting before breaking the bad news, even signposting before giving the information or after breaking the bad news. So for example, if you are going to discuss with the patient that is suspected to have an ovarian cancer, still you can't sign both. Sarah, I appreciate that you are worried that you might have an ovarian cancer, but it would be very helpful for me if I just ask you some few questions first before I explain the result of your scan. So the patient is worried. So sign both and ask before. If the patient is insisting, if the patient asks you 2 questions or 1 question twice or more than twice in the exam, you have to stop and answer her concern. So if you are breaking the bad news and you want to wait to take the information from the patient before breaking the news, but the patient is insisting, she asked you twice, is there anything wrong with my result? I'm worried about my result. Can you tell me if there is anything wrong? So at this point, stop. Break the bad news. Show empathy. Show your understanding. Show how you will go through the usual scheme of breaking the bad news. And then later, ask her permission to continue or no and continue the information gathering. So signposting is very important in the information gathering, especially in sensitive situation. Communication skills, again, is important in information gathering. So information gathering and communication are mixed, and you may be evaluated in both domains in the same part. So the communication skill is an important part in information gathering. So your correct body language, you are actively listening to the patient. Actively listening means you are asking the question and you are listening to the answer. Some candidates, they are only asking the question just for asking. So they will not get the answer of the patient, so they will repeat the question again. And if you repeat the question, this will be against you in the communication and the information gathering. So means you are wasting your time and you are not listening to the patient. In a structured discussion, information gathering may be involved. The information gathering in a structured discussion will be asking about any results of investigation. You are asking about any additional information. You will ask about any more information else you want, any other investigations. And once you ask about the information or the investigation, please stop and ask the examiner if they have any information or they have any result. Because sometimes the examiner will have the result of the scan, will have the result of the investigation. He will not give you if you didn't ask him if there is any data regarding the information you asked for. So stop in the structured discussion after you mention the further information you need, after you mention the investigation you want for the case as the examination finding, and ask the examiner, is there is any available data regarding these points? At this, he may give you the scan, he may give you the examination finding or the investigation results. And interpretation of these results will be also considered as a point of information gathering. Writing a task like discharge letter or multidisciplinary team, again, it is a form of information gathering and again, form of communication. So what are the common mistakes of information gathering? Wasting your time by asking irrelevant questions. Wasting 6 or 7 minutes asking about irrelevant question in a task that you were asked to take a targeted relevant history. You should see if you need to take a detailed history or targeted and the relevant history. Targeted and relevant history, you have to ask questions regarding the patient complaint only. But detailed history means you have to go through the scheme of the history in all points. Very, very dangerous point when you are asking all your questions as closed questions. Closed questions, the role player will answer yes or no, yes or no. So she will not give you her concerns. She will not give you any cues about the hidden agendas of the station. Repeating the question means you are not listening to the patient. And this will affect the information gathering and the communication with the patient. So please not to repeat the question. If you need to repeat a question, ask simply. If you didn't listen or if you didn't get it, if you were distracted, just simply tell the role player, I'm sorry, I didn't understand. Can you tell me more? Can you tell me what do you mean? So it means that you were listening, but you didn't understand here. It will be much better than you were listening, but you are not interested or you are not taking care of what she's telling. So instead of repeating this question, so I didn't understand. So can you please tell me or explain more for me? The patient will give you cues during the information gathering and the communication. Ignoring these cues will affect your information gathering and will affect your communication. So again, how to develop or how to improve your information gathering skills? finding the appropriate partner or the exam body. You need to find someone to help you. In the course, I will help, I will try to help my best, but I will not be with you every day. So you should have an exam partner, a study partner that will be with you every day. You should practice every day. You should have at least two partners, because if one is busy, the two others will communicate with each other and they can practice. If all fails, if you don't have these options, again, recording. Believe me, recording for yourself will improve you to a very much high level you do not expect. Criticize yourself before anyone criticize you. Appraise or praise your performance. See what are the negative points and what are the weak points and what are the positive points in your performance. To improve your information and your communication, you should have an opening statement and an open questions. So opening statements, hello, hi, I'm Dr. Sroor, one of the doctors in the clinic today. Can I confirm your name and age, please? I understand that you are here because your GP transferred you because you have some pain for your long time. Is that correct? Do you have any other concerns or expectation? Is it okay if I ask you some few questions? Then this is the agenda. Then I may need to examine you in presence of chaperone. I may need to run some more tests or scans. Then I will discuss all the open options for your case. After reaching an agreed plan of management, I will involve my consultant in the plan and I will arrange the next appointment with him. I will write back to your GP or the midwife and I will give you a useful information leaflet. So can you tell me more about your condition? So remember these opening statements, remember the intro, it will save your time and it will save your marks. So in the phrase I just said now, it will save so many marks. Now you talk borderline in the communication, you talk borderline in the information gathering, you talk borderline in the safety. The remaining, you have to take bus if you will perform well in the station, then you, if you manage to say other points in the communication, information gathering, and the safety, you will pass these domains and the rest will be depending in your clinical knowledge. So the introduction and the closure of the station are very important for you to pass the exam. It's very simple to pass the exam, but remember the simple points that you have to mention during the introduction and during the closure of the station. Again, your partner has to count how many open questions and how many closed questions you ask during the practice. So from today, while you are practicing together, you will tell your partner how many open and how many closed questions you mentioned during the station. Recording. Record for yourself. Record for yourself. It is a way to avoid getting embarrassed. From the next session again, the cameras will be open and everything will be recorded. So start recording for yourself before I will start my recording. In the information gathering, remember the signposting when it is necessary. Again, to avoid feeling embarrassed, you have to practice in front of others, in front of your exam partner, and in front of all of us during the course. Please do not get embarrassed to practice. This is the first step to pass in the exam. Make it as a usual way of discussion between your colleagues or a usual way of discussion with your patient. Most of us, we don't like to be observed during our clinics or during our surgeries. But the first step to pass the exam, to get rid out of this habit, you have to practice in front of the others. You have to accept being criticized and to accept the feedback, because this will be the first step in passing the Part 3 exam. Any questions in the information gathering? Any questions? So if you are happy, I will move to the next domain, because we are running out of time and the prayer time is coming. So the applied clinical knowledge. Most of the candidates, they are wasting the preparation time in the applied clinical knowledge. Dr. Amal was asking, and Dr. Sadia and one more else was asking, do I need to go through all the talks, through all the guidelines, through all the nice guidelines and books? No, you don't have. I can see that we have fresh candidates who passed the exam in 2022 and in 2020, so you still have knowledge. What you need is to refresh your information. Refreshing your information will be from the information leaflet and from the summaries at the start of each green top guideline, or only the headings in the nice guidelines. If you don't have any information about the topic, quickly go through it. Quickly go through it. Don't waste your time in the clinical knowledge alone. This exam is not only about the clinical knowledge. Yes, the clinical knowledge is important, but it is not the only domain in the station. So it is important to have a clinical knowledge. It is important to justify why you need this test, why you need this drug, and understanding why you need it. It is considered or part of the clinical knowledge. The common pitfalls when you are not honest with yourself. So now ask yourself an honest question. Do I have a good base of information, good base of knowledge? Because if you don't have, if you lost the knowledge at all, you have to cover these gaps of your clinical knowledge. How to cover it? Again, cover the knowledge by the patient information leaflet, by the summaries at the front, at the start of each guideline. In the exam, there is what's called a scattergun approach. A scattergun approach, you have some knowledge. You have some information about the task, but you don't have firm information. So you will say all the information you will have about the task without any specification. So the examiner will observe this. He will observe that you are just mentioning any information that come to your mind, which are not relevant to the patient complaint or the patient problem. This is called scattergun approach, and it will affect your mark in the clinical knowledge. When you act like a slave, what is the meaning of slave? You are following a fixed or relevant way, a non-relevant way of applying the guideline to the condition of the patient. So you know the guideline, but you don't know which point of the guideline you will apply to this patient. This is called, you are following the guideline as a slave without optimizing or taking the relevant point of the guideline to the relevant complaint of the patient. You should individualize your management according to each patient. So you should manage according to the comorbidity of the patient. Each patient has to be individualized in the management, and this will reflect your clinical knowledge. Your clinical knowledge will be affected also by your plan of management according to the wishes of the patient. So you have to answer the concern and ask the patient about her concern, if she needs medical treatment, if she needs surgical treatment, and according to which you will take the relevant point of the guideline and apply it to the patient. But if you are not listening to the patient wishes, you will tell her all the information about all the ways of the management, and this will waste your time, and this will be considered again as a scattergun approach. You do not understand the main problem and you are not taking the relevant parts from the guideline to apply to the patient complaint. These are the common points of failure in the clinical knowledge. How to develop your clinical knowledge? Be honest. Be honest. Ask yourself and answer yourself. Do I need to cover some gaps in my clinical knowledge? If you need, you will do more effort. You will go to the guidelines that you completely forgot. You can go quickly through it. You still have 5 months. 5 months are more than enough for preparation of the exam. If you have the knowledge, 1 or 2 months are quite enough for preparation. So if you don't have the knowledge, you can go quickly through the guidelines, the hidden, the summaries, and the most important is the patient information leaflets. Ask yourself every day about the cases you are managing in your clinic or in your hospital. Are you following the guidance? Do you develop an individualized plan for each case according to the guideline? Did you ask for unnecessary investigations? And can you formulate a management plan which is more patient-centered, which means patient management plan according to the patient concern? If the answers are yes, means you are good in the clinical knowledge and all what you need is to improve your practice in the other domains. If no, please review your level in the guidelines and go back and the patient information leaflet, the summaries for each guideline and the NICE guidelines. And if you don't have any information about certain topics, you may go and quickly read it. So this is a way how to improve your part of the clinical knowledge. Any questions? Any questions? Okay, so finally, the prescription. How to prepare for the exam. Today is the introduction session. How we will start preparing the exam? We have 5 months from now. From today, you should read at least 2 patient information leaflets. The patient information leaflet will take maximum 15 minutes. 15 minutes. 4 or 5 pages, and there are diagrams and drawings in the papers. So the patient information leaflet will take maximum 15 minutes. So if you read 2 patient information leaflet daily, it will take maximum 30 minutes. 2 executive summaries from the CTG or the NICE. The summaries at the start of the guideline, 2 of them daily. 2 tasks or stations that are related to the guideline or to the patient information leaflet that you studied today. So now you covered all the aspects of this guideline. You read it as a summary. You read the jargon. You know how to convert the jargon into lay language by reading the patient information leaflet. You will know what are the expected questions that you will be asked by the role player during the stage. All the questions that you will be asked in the station are written in the information leaflet. So be ready to answer these questions. Then practice 2 stations which are related to the guideline or to the patient information leaflet. So this is the rule of 2. 2 patient information leaflets daily, 2 summaries, 2 stations, and 2 study partners. As I said, if one is busy, the other one will be available. If you are unlucky and the 2 are busy in this state, in this situation, you record for yourself. Recording, please record for yourself. When you practice the reading time in 2 minutes. You should have the key points I mentioned at the beginning, the situation awareness, what you will write in the notes, and what's your agenda. You should practice reading the candidate instruction and write these notes in 2 minutes. Then the station, totally, you should practice the station in 9 minutes. Don't practice in 10 minutes. Because if you practice in 9 minutes, you will get used to finish the station before time. Because time management was very important and still very important for some candidates who are wasting the domains by wasting the time only in information gathering. So practice in 9 minutes, 3 minutes for the information gathering and 6 minutes for the remaining domains. Ask for a feedback from your study partner according to the domain. So when you are studying together, and this will be the way of giving you the feedback during the course, I will tell you what you did good and you did bad in each domain. So ask your study partner also, how did I do in the safety? What did I do in the communication? And now I will send you the PDF of this lecture. You will have the points to be evaluated in each of the domains. So your partner will check the points that you did and they didn't do, and they will give you a constructive feedback at the end of your practice. This is from today, the rule of two from today. Then, once you book the exam, you will increase the number of stations to 7 stations or tasks per day. From here to the day of the booking, I think you can finish the information leaflets. So once you book the exam, at least 7 stations or tasks daily. In the last months before exam, you should have a circuit daily. What is the meaning of circuit daily? You should do 14 tasks daily in the months before the exam. You may say this is too much, how I will arrange a time, but the 14 stations, you will finish in the exam in 3 hours. So I cannot expect from any one of you who's going for the exam to study less than 3 hours in the months before the exam. So at least 14 stations in the months before the exam, this will improve your performance. This will change you completely. You will feel that you are a different person and you will pass the exam. You will do it. Please believe me, if you will perform, if you practice more, you have a very good chance of passing the exam. This is a recommendation of the college, not my recommendation, to take an online course. We are doing now one online course. If you have a chance to do one face-to-face circuit, on-site circuit, it's better to do one on-site circuit. But the problem is on the on-site circuit, you have to travel maybe to UK or to any other place to do the on-site. If you have this option, it will be better. You will live the real exam setting and the real exam standard. You will have a good experience about the exam. If you don't have this option, do one of the mock exam circuits. So this is the prescription and this is the conclusion of our introduction session today. I hope it was useful. I will send you the PDF on the group. You can have all the points for all the domains, all the domains you will be tested. You can use it with your study partner or your exam partner. I'm ready for any question from now. I will close the recording. Then we can stop. Thank you so much and hope it was of benefit for all of you.